Welcome. And I guess I should say welcome back. It's nice to see you all here tonight. As you know, this is our first public event, our second event of the year, both of them on terrorism. I wanted to say a few things about what's happening at the center before we get started, although I think most of you know. This is our eighth year. Isn't that amazing? I don't feel 8 years older, do you, Peter? I don't. Nope. Peter's been with us since the beginning. So it's our eighth year, and we're starting rather propitiously because we have brand new digs of several thousand square feet. And it's amazing to come up there. So I welcome you to all come and visit. We have a number of new fellows, many of whom are very young. We've sort of gone to the other end of the spectrum to try to see who
Why
might
are you
have
looking at me?
Better. Well, I'm reminding you that there are young people besides that we used to be young. This is our eight-year thing. We are really looking at younger fellows and the idea that maybe there can be some new, fresh thinking about security. Not that us older people haven't done a really good job, but we could have done a better job, right?
Always could do a better job.
So my vote is for the youth, which I think is appropriate to a university anyway. We have two new products I want to talk to you about. One of them is our newest product, which is the TTN, or Today's Terrorism News, which comes out every morning at somewhere between 9 and 9:30, which is my favorite thing in the whole world. You just go on, and it'll tell you all the stories you need to know that are relevant to us. So sometimes it's the mosque, and sometimes it's what's happening in the courts, like with Abdulmutallab today saying that he wanted to represent himself. And sometimes it's something about Afghanistan and Pakistan, if it's relevant to our formerly called War on Terror. And sometimes it's just something that we think is interesting and that you should think about, like right-wing extremist terrorism in the United States and why you might want to think about that and not just Muslim extremist terrorism. One of my favorite features on it is a roundup of foreign news about these issues. So, for example, we look at how the rest of the world is responding to our mosque controversy, and I think you might be somewhat surprised. Now, if I could tell you how to get to this, it's www.centerlineblog.org, and I invite you to visit it and then to let us know if you want us to send it to you, which we have a way to do, but that's not my expertise. But if you write us and say, just send it to me so I don't have to log on to it, that's fine, and we will do that. Yes, it's www.centerlineblog. Our blog is called the Centerline Blog, centerlineblog.org. And you can always call us and ask us or whatever. And then the second thing that I wanted to mention was that our terrorist trial report card, which is the thing we're most well known for, I think, came out this week, and it will be up on our, we will send it out tomorrow to everybody. So if you're on our list, if you signed up for our list today, if you're on our list from before, you will get it. And I think I'll get to talk about it today because I've read it, so it'll make me, I know more. But anyway, as you know, every year we issue a report on how our Department of Justice and law enforcement has what they've done in terms of prosecuting terrorists, or as some would say, in their counterterrorism efforts. And in the past, we've looked at prosecutions, compared indictments to convictions, and just looked at the overall record. This year, we did something a little different, which was to look at a little bit at who we're actually indicting and who we are convicting. And there are some very surprising results, which I will bring up at appropriate moments in this conversation. But I suggest, if you're interested in this, you look at it. And basically, the report, just to give you a little hint, is about homegrown terrorism and the way it's being articulated in our courts. And I think something worth that the country as a whole does not have a sense of. So those are my introductory welcoming comments. This is kind of a new panel for us. We haven't had, other than Peter, who's comes in graciously all the time, we have new people with us. And so I thought I would introduce them. You know, I'm not big on long introductions. You have their bios in the preliminary material. To my far left is Juan Zarate. He was Deputy National Security Advisor for Combating Terrorism in the White House. He is currently at the Center for Strategic and International Studies in Washington, and he is the CBS correspondent on
national security,
and especially terrorism, right? Okay.
Perfect. Thank you.
In between us is Mitchell Silber. It's kind of, I'm a little embarrassed that we haven't had Mitch here before. He's on the front lines at the NYPD. As you know, the center has always admired the NYPD, and we try to bring one or more of them here as often as we can. We try to compete with their analytical bureau, but we know that we don't come close, but we really try. that's why we bring them here, to just sort of see what they're up to. And he's director of intelligence analysis at the police department. And Mitch is one of those people who's crossed over between the academic world and the policy world. Prior to being at the NYPD, he was at Columbia. He's the author of the much noted, in fact, the only really noted study on radicalization that came out in 2007. And it's still the baseline, even though it's 3 years ago and somebody else should do something else, maybe even you. But it's still the baseline. But like, you know, I think things are changing rather rapidly, and it's one of the things we're going to talk about tonight. And then on my right is Peter Bergen, who I must have had like 60 or 100 times of introducing you, so I don't think I have any. But Peter has a new book coming out called The Longest War. He seems to like the word war in the titles to his books, except one in which he doesn't have war is The Osama Bin Laden I Know, and which was really well received a few years ago, and which I particularly like as a book if you want to sort of get in the side, the head of understanding who some of these people who identify with jihad are, and just how Bin Laden plays out in the imaginations and lives of many people. So I invite you to read that book, but mostly I invite you to tell Peter afterwards how you can't wait to read his new book, which I thought we were going to talk about last year, but now we have it this year, so we're really excited. When's it coming out?
January 11th.
Oh, that's the day Guantanamo opened. How incredibly poignant that would be. Okay, so January 11th. So we'll do something here on January 11th. Don't say that. So the way we're going to do tonight is I thought we would start with Peter. Peter also, I should say, issued another a report this week with Bruce Hoffman, who's one of our best terrorism experts in the country, on terrorism trials. That's sort of a counterpart to our own. So I suggest that you read them together, and then Peter and I will tell you how they don't disagree at all, even though it might seem like they do. That's like our goal in life. Okay, so the way we're going to organize today is we're going to leave a lot of room for the audience to talk, because there are actually a number of people in the audience that I could have asked to be up here and didn't. And so if you don't talk, I'll call on you. So either way, it's going to be a discussion with the audience. And Peter, I thought, would start by giving us sort of a global view of what's changed in the world of the terrorist threat, how he perceives it, how he thinks homegrown terrorism fits into this larger global assessment. And he's going to do that in like 7 minutes. But he talks very fast, and so I know it's going to work. So go ahead.
Thank you very much, Karen, for the invitation. Now, I'm glad you mentioned the word war, because I think President Obama had a sort of interesting decision to make about defining what kind of conflict we're involved in when he came into office. And obviously on the left wing of the Democratic Party, And in Europe in general, there was some pressure to sort of make this a global police action against terrorists. And I, sort of the GPAT, as opposed to the GWAT, the Global War on Terror that Bush declared. And I think that would have been a mistake in the sense that if you look at the largest British terrorist attack in British history before Al-Qaeda attacked on 7/7, the attack killed 29 people. And so you're talking about a very, you know, the European context for terrorism is quite different, and I don't think it's really applicable to what happened on 9/11. Similarly, Al-Qaeda declare war on us. It's not, you know, they declare war in multiple times before 9/11. So when one side declares war and then does warlike activities like blowing up embassies, warships, attacking civilians, thousands of civilians as they go to work on a Tuesday morning, Clearly, they're at war with us, and we can pretend that this isn't a war, but I think it is. And so I think President Obama correctly said that we're at war with al-Qaeda and its allies, which I think was a very useful formulation, because it suggests that you can de-ally yourself from al-Qaeda, or you can join al-Qaeda in a sense. And Lashkar-e-Taiba, I think, in a sense, is migrating towards al-Qaeda. If you look at the Mumbai attacks, they specifically targeted Jewish Americans' center. And of course, they employed an American to do the scoping. David Headley of Chicago was critical to scoping out the targets. And so just a comment just on the larger frame in which we're looking at this. Now, the question then, I think we are at war, the question is, what kind of damage can they do to us? And I think the answer is not very much right now. I mean, if Northwest 253 had blown up, hundreds of people would have died in the plane and some on the ground. Is that a national security problem, or is that a second order threat? And in the post 9/11 environment, maybe that is a national security problem. When Pan Am 103 blew up over Scotland, killing 270 people in 1988, did that completely change American foreign policy? The answer is no. In fact, Pan Am 103, there was absolutely no response from the US government at all until many years later, when the Libyans were fingered for the attack. So, but if the outer ceiling of al-Qaeda's abilities right now is to either kill dozens of people here in New York, as Najibullah Zazi was planning, or kill hundreds of people in an American airliner, while it's a big deal, it's certainly not existential, and certainly doesn't rise to the World War IV or the fight against fascism or communism, which was initially portrayed by the Bush administration. And a side point to that is, if you look at the 172 jihadi terrorist cases since 9/11, not one of them has involved weapons of mass destruction, by which I mean chemical, biological, radiological, or nuclear weapons, even crude types. And so their abilities in this area have been very limited, and there have been no cases in that area. Who is being recruited? I think one thing that is different from before is, you know, we've now got American leaders of these groups. Now, this is historically quite unusual. Ali Mohammed was the only leader of al-Qaeda who could really, took a leadership role, who was really an American. But here you've got Shukra Juma, who grew up in Brooklyn in Florida, who's now al-Qaeda's leader of external operations. Now you've got Omar Hamami, a Baptist convert to Islam in Alabama, who is taking a leadership role in al-Shabaab in Somalia. Now you've got David Headley, who played an instrumental role in LET in Mumbai. And you also have, of course, al-Lawki in Yemen. And I think that's a little bit different. And of course, you've got more Americans self-recruiting to these groups than you have had in the past. And also, you've got Americans who are exporting the jihad overseas. We used to worry about Sunni militants coming here. But when Headley is going to Mumbai and also going to Copenhagen to scope out attacks on a Danish cartoonist, or when Jihad Jane is planning an attack on a Swedish artist who also painted an offensive cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad, we're in a slightly different situation. So, the other point to make is, in the last couple of years, the ethnic profile of these groups is, of the people joining these groups, there is no ethnic profile. I mean, Jihad Jane is a 46-year-old high school dropout, Caucasian. David Headley is Pakistani-American. I mean, there's many, many different types of people joining these groups. What are the factors working for or against these groups? I think working for these groups is the fact that al-Qaeda has intellectually infected other groups that don't call themselves al-Qaeda. And I think this is a big deal, because Lashkar-e-Taiba is a group with literally thousands and thousands of people. Above ground operation has 2,200 offices in Pakistan. When it has an annual meeting, several hundred thousand people show up. This is a very large group with quite a lot of capacity. And the Pakistani Taliban, similarly, it should have been a warning sign that they sent suicide bombers to Barcelona in January of 2008, and that was not sufficiently absorbed. The idea was that these people were only interested in their local problems rather than self-identifying as part of the global jihad. So that's one strength of al-Qaeda. Then, of course, the regional affiliates, some are going up, some are going down. Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb is pretty weak. Al-Qaeda in Iraq is sort of back, and I think that was predictable. You've still got the leadership of al-Qaeda still out there, bin Laden, Ayman al-Zawahiri. And, of course, our own overreactions can help these groups. So those are the positives for these groups. On the negative side of the ledger, I would say drone attacks have had some interruption, although Najibullah Zazi and Faisal Shazad were able to travel and get training in the tribal regions after the drone program was ramped up. I think increasingly negative attitudes by the Pakistani military, government, and population to these groups certainly has been becoming a problem. If you look at support for suicide bombing, Taliban, al-Qaeda, it's dropping precipitously. The caveat to that is that even groups with virtually no public support can still do a lot of damage, as we saw that in the 1970s in Germany with the Bader-Meinhof gang, which is only a couple of dozen people. The story in Pakistan, of course, is being repeated around the Muslim world, and they're losing the war of the ideas in the Muslim world, not because we're winning it, which was always a very naive view of how this would proceed, but because they're losing it, and of course they're taking incoming ideological fire from former allies and people they look to for religious inspiration. In fact, we just published on the AFPAC channel an open letter from Benoman to Osama bin Laden, in which he was incredibly explicit about his criticism of bin Laden in English, for the first time in a sort of formal letter to bin Laden. And so that, I think that is, if we're looking at the beginning of the end or the end of the beginning, the fact that they're losing the war of ideas, that they didn't ignite a global sort of Islamic revolution as they planned and are very unlikely to, suggests that they're small men on the wrong side of history, as Obama said at West Point relatively recently.
Okay, I have a couple of just follow-up.
A couple of follow-up things that I want to ask you. One is, you see the United States as an increasing exporter, basically, of jihad, that homegrown terrorism would be, in other words, people who are radicalized here or who live here and then who go abroad. But what about the threat that, this is two parts of this question. What about the threat, in your estimation, that they pose to the United States? That's the first thing. The second thing is, in your talking about global jihad, one of the things you've always been most thoughtful about is what bin Laden and the original al-Qaeda's motives are in terms of what they want. And you've always said, and I could be wrong, but it's my impression that you've always focused on building a caliphate, a worldwide caliphate, a religious Islamic world. And so I'm wondering if you see that is changing, and particularly, is it changing in terms of instead of global jihad, but a more global identification with Muslim suffering, and if you distinguish between those things. So I know it's kind of a lot of questions, but it was kind of embedded
I think bin Laden is a smart guy, but he's a very bad strategist. I mean, if the idea that attacking us on 9/11 was going to get us to pull out of the Middle East, and then the regimes around the region would crumble, I mean, precisely the opposite has happened. We're in the Middle East in a much larger way. The authoritarian regimes he's hoping to overthrow are much stronger. And from a strategic point of view, it's been a total dud. So I think, but what these guys do is that they'll seek any explanation that makes sense of their actions. So they'll say, well, we're really trying to bleed America economically, or, he'll find something to sort of explain their actions. But, Noman Benoitman, who I mentioned earlier, I think he, when I was doing this book about bin Laden, he said the single smartest thing, which is really obvious until it's said, like a lot of obvious things, needs to be said, which is the tactics took over the strategy. I mean, there is no strategic goal. Sun Tzu says, the tactics without strategy is a noise before defeat. And that's basically, I think, a very good description of where al-Qaeda is today. On the question of what threat to the United States do these people going overseas for jihad, I think in the case of the Somalis, probably very much, very minimal, because these guys are the subject of very intense law enforcement interest from people like Mitch Silber. Their names are well known. They come here, they'll be indicted, or they'll be followed, or they'll be surveyed. I think the concern is much more that they would attack an American target in East Africa. I mean, Shabab has already shown with its attack in Uganda and its attempted attack on the Danish cartoonists that it can do out-of-area operations. And so I think that's more of a concern, particularly when people are identified. But on the other hand, it's not like Faisal Shahzad, who's not been identified by law enforcement. He can go over and he can get training. So I think in the case when these people are well known already to law enforcement, they don't really pose a threat here, but they might pose a threat to Americans overseas.
Okay, I think we should go from the global to the local. That would be you, Mitch. We don't really think of New York City as local, but we'll pretend for the sake of argument. And just sort of how this looks from your point of view and the challenges you see and the basically what's changing, if anything, and what it means. And this will be part of your next report, right?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's accurate. NYPD and New York City in general always look at the global as local. It seems like whatever's going on in the world seems to have some type of application to New York City. I want to begin with the local and tell you that the NYPD Intelligence Division and the NYPD Counterterrorism Bureau have been the busiest that we've ever been over the last 12 months. And the nature of the global jihadist threat led by al-Qaeda in the vanguard that both the United States and New York City face has evolved over the past 2 years. And it's this change that's driving our increased operational tempo. And I'll give you three examples that'll provide an illustration of that, of the composition of the threat that we face. The first has to do with August of 2008, when three unremarkable graduates from Flushing High School, from Queens, naturalized citizens of Afghan and Balkan origin, depart from Newark Airport to Peshawar, Pakistan. These men are all in their 20s. They worked as a building superintendent, a New York City cab driver, ran a coffee cart by Wall Street. Their purpose in traveling to Pakistan was to join the fight against U.S.-led coalition forces in Afghanistan. But through circumstance and not design, they met individuals linked to al-Qaeda. They attended training facilities run by al-Qaeda, and they were taught how to construct hydrogen peroxide-based improvised explosive devices, not dissimilar from what the 7-7 bombers did in London. These men returned to the U.S. in February of 2009, and by last September, we're in the final stages of launching a suicide attack against the New York subway system that, as Peter says, would have killed dozens, you know, hundreds is probably the uppermost limit. Second example is from July of 2009, a 30-year-old Bridgeport University MBA graduate who lived in Connecticut travels to Pakistan. He also wanted to get into the fight against U.S.-led coalition forces, and also through circumstance and not really design, was introduced to members of an al-Qaeda ally, the Pakistani Taliban, or Tehriki Taliban. He was given some training. He was sent back to the U.S. in February. And on May 1, he drove into Times Square with his explosive-laden Nissan Pathfinder, looking to explode it in the midst of a busy spring Saturday night. The third case is one that we've looked at for 4 years from suburban New Jersey. We observed the radicalization of two men, one a Dominican convert to Islam, the other an individual of Palestinian descent. And by 2009, November, these men seemed to be inspired by the ideas of al-Qaeda, and they began to consider themselves soldiers. They began to train for war, and they subsequently purchased airline tickets to Egypt as a way station to Somalia. They planned on joining an al-Qaeda ally, al-Shabaab, and they told the NYPD undercover officer who had penetrated their conspiracy, God willing, I'll never come back. I'll never see this crap hole. You're referring to New Jersey there. But that's what the undercover said. I don't know. The only way I would come back here is if I was in the land of jihad and the leader ordered me to come back here and do something here. Ah, I love that. So this idea of being redirected back to the United States, like Zazi, like Faisal Shahzad. But fortunately, they arrested this past June at JFK. But what these three examples illustrate and have in common is that they underscore the way the nature of the al-Qaeda threat has changed. The al-Qaeda threat is fractured. It's decentralized. It's not just al-Qaeda core from September 11, 2001. There are three dimensions: al-Qaeda core, al-Qaeda affiliates and allies, and the al-Qaeda inspired. And what's also, as Peter noted, is this preponderance of Americans who are radicalizing to violence, looking to join jihad overseas, whether through core, whether affiliate and ally, or autonomously in a homegrown plot. And over the last 24 months, we've counted about 50 Americans who have either been indicted, arrested, or participants in terrorism-related activities abroad. So, you know, radicalization in the West, and specifically in the United States, is clearly on the rise. So the question of these three dimensions of al-Qaeda, what's our assessment of sort of how they rank and what's going on among them? For core, meaning the actual organization headed by bin Laden and Zawahiri overseas that are in these badlands between Afghanistan and Pakistan, the operational capabilities are seriously degraded. Probably the group was only maybe 200 people at its peak, and some estimates, Peter's report cites, down to maybe 50, 100 individuals. U.S.-led group boots on the ground, military efforts, and probably most importantly, the drone attacks have done their damage. Three attacks in Pakistan in 2007, and I'm basing this on the New America Foundation data, which we rely on and find very useful. 34 attacks in 2008, and 113 attacks since January 2009, up to Sunday or so. I think there have been a couple since. But, you know, by our calculation, al-Qaeda has gone through at least seven different chiefs of external operations, and that's the role that launches attacks against the West. Either they've been caught, killed, or died of natural causes. In 06, since 06, Al-Qaeda Corps has really only been able to launch one plot against the West that reached operational maturity, the Zazi plot. That said, bin Laden and Zawahiri are still alive. They still have smaller and mobile training camps that we know Zazi and his associates went to. They're being provided sanctuary by the Pakistani Taliban and more specifically the Haqqani network. The ideology's still out there, and they're still attracting Western recruits. But that's core. As far as the affiliates go, Al-Qaeda Corps' ideology has caught on, and a number of these different groups, in fact, an alphabet soup of them, have changed their goals. It used to be focused on the liberation of Kashmir or the overthrow of the Afghan government, so local in-theater grievances, but now they've changed and developed a relationship with Al-Qaeda Corps, and there's a wide range from just ideological affinity to operational coordination, sharing training camps, sharing fighters, tactics, and funds. And in fact, some of these groups have even changed their name to show this association with Al-Qaeda Corps. The GSPC is now Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb. AQAP, Al-Qaeda of the Arabian Peninsula, changed their name. But still some of these other groups like LET, Tehrik-e-Taliban, they're associating more closely with Al-Qaeda. What's new here is that these groups are now targeting and projecting their power toward the West, and that's new. And over the last 3 years, there have been five plots targeting the West from Al-Qaeda affiliates and allies. The Copenhagen plot that LET sought to launch in 2008 against the Jyllands Postens newspaper, the Christmas Day plot by Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, and the Tehrik-e-Taliban plot May 1st. So all plots directed out of theater, and that's new. And that brings us to the third leg, the Al-Qaeda inspired, and this plethora of individuals who since 9/11 living in Western countries who were inspired by the Al-Qaeda jihadist message. These individuals don't have formalized links to AQ or an AQ affiliate, but they have ideological affinity with them. And these individuals are probably what NYPD ranks as one of our top threats among the three. Now, we've been tracking plots over the last, really, since 93, but what's interesting is that between 2005 and 2009, so a five-year period, out of the 32 plots targeting the West, 22 were by autonomous or homegrown. So two-thirds of these plots launched by individuals who had no link to the overseas organization other than ideological affinity. So clearly this dimension is on the ascent. Which brings me to probably the most important part of my talk, which is what is driving young men in the West, and now specifically the United States, to radicalize to Al-Qaeda-inspired violence. And what we believe is behind it is the proliferation of Al-Qaeda in English. And this is also new. And it takes the form of three dimensions. One is the official Al-Qaeda websites that increasingly are being subtitled in English language. So footage from the battlefield in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Somalia, in Yemen, is now being put on the internet with English language subtitles, which appeals and is available to a much broader audience. Also propaganda from affiliates. The Inspire magazine that Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula put out this May in English and seeking to do exactly that, inspire people in the West to act. And they provide directions. How to build a bomb in your kitchen. It's in English, it's available. Someone in New York tonight is looking at that magazine and seeing those directions. And probably most importantly is the American spiritual sanctioners or Al-Qaeda ideologues who are out there. And Peter touched on them as well. Now, Anwar al-Awlaki, who has gotten a tremendous amount of coverage over the last year, year and a half, has been linked to a number of different plots that are very concerning. The Transatlantic Airline plot, the Toronto 18 plot, the 2007 Fort Dix, New Jersey plot, the Zazi plot, Times Square, and the recent case of these two individuals in New Jersey who sought to fight overseas in Somalia. They watched his videos. They listened to his tapes. They had his recordings on their cell phones, listening to them. Yeah, as well as Hassan, who we know about. And coupled with Omar Hamami, another American, who's broadcasting on behalf of al-Shabaab, and a New Yorker, most likely Samir Khan, believed to be the author of this Inspire magazine, together these individuals are almost a Tokyo Rose of the terror wars, broadcasting back from the battlefield to Americans trying to motivate people to fight. The net result, and I'll end where I began, is that the NYPD, the FBI, and other federal and local law enforcement and intelligence agencies are busier than ever trying to detect and disrupt these individuals who are increasingly Americans who are radicalizing to violence and seeking to join or commit a terrorist act on behalf of Al-Qaeda or one of their affiliates.
That was a little scary. Can I just ask you a couple questions to sort of put it in a maybe different context, which is that, first of all, and we can talk about this afterwards, I'm not sure they're increasingly Americans, because some of the statistics you gave about their two-thirds Americans, at least our research here shows, has been a consistent pattern since at least 9/11 and before that. There were a number of homegrown incidents here in New York. What I do think is interesting is that there is some kind of pull towards identifying yourself with jihad that we haven't quite felt before. That doesn't quite turn them into terrorists, but sort of. And so I'm just wondering if you have a sense of what this used to be in the past. Is it people who are going into gangs that are now going to identify with Al-Qaeda or some, you know, Al-Qaeda affiliate? Is it people who would have identified maybe with a protest movement earlier on, like the Weather Underground or something? What's happened that it's become, or do you think this is a completely new phenomenon? And is there any thought about that? Because from a counterterrorism point of view, which is what Juan's going to talk about, I think it might be important to have some sense of historical context. Is there any sense of that when you're thinking about it? Why is this the only form of dissent and anger, or what? What are your thoughts on that?
Right. Well, let me break it up into two parts. I guess the first part is, you know, the new question, which I think is, you know, new is not a binary. Either it's new or it's not. I think it's more of incremental. You know, have there been Americans involved in jihadist terrorism? You know, as Peter noted, you know, from the beginning, you know, clearly, yes, mm-hmm. Go back to 93, mm-hmm. And 94, the landmark plot. But I think it's the frequency, and it's the frequency over the last few years, numbers of Americans, mm-hmm. that's what's on the rise. And when we put out the 2007 radicalization report, you know, part of the feedback in Washington was the question of, you know, are we really going to see this in the United States? Yes, we see it in Europe, we see it in the UK, we see it on the continent, but are we going to see that in the United States? You know, Juan and I were talking before, and the question is, you know, it was a yes or no, but it was more of a more nuanced. We could see it more than we've seen it before, and I think that's what's happened. Some of the trend lines that were in Europe have now caught up to the United States, thanks to the internet and this broadcast in English by Americans. So, you know, from that standpoint, we're saying it's on the rise. And then to part two of the question is, you know, what trajectory might some of these other people have gone otherwise? You know, I think some of these individuals, I mean, we're seeing a large number of individuals, converts involved. So Hispanic converts, African-American converts, might they have gone a gang route? These two individuals, Almonte and Alessa, and in fact, they had a gang. They called themselves the Arabian Nights, you know. They were neither Arabian nor Knights, but it was a catchy name, and they were involved with low-level criminality in New Jersey, but, you know, they might have gone a gang route. People who knew Vinyas out on Long Island said this guy, quote-unquote, according to Long Island law enforcement, he was a punk. Instead, he goes to Afghanistan and joins Al-Qaeda and, you know, goes to training camp. So, yeah, they might have gone that other route. This is now another avenue for disenfranchised people. We've got a grievance.
So Juan, tell us why. You're going to talk to us about counterterrorism, but it seems to me from what Mitch said that what you have to do is come up with alternative groups to identify with. So
and strategies.
Enlighten
and, yeah.
us.
No, that's exactly right. Karen, first of all, thank you for having me. I appreciate it. Thank you to NYU and to the Center. It's really a privilege for me to be up here with Mitch and Peter, whom I respect greatly, and congratulations to both of them on great work over the past few years, especially Peter, your most recent report. I completely agree with what has been said in terms of the ground shifting under us in the context of the threat that we face. And I think though we are not seeing phenomenon that are wholly new. And I, Karen, I agree with you. I think some of the analysis that we've seen, and certainly some of the political discussion we've seen in Washington, seems to assume that we've seen the homegrown terrorist problem emerge in January of 2009, and that there's no history or tail to this. But certainly we are seeing a shift, and I would concur with my colleague's assessment. I often call it the terrorist hydra, because you have multiple heads to the problem, driven in part by the AQ core, but with regional affiliates, like-minded groups like Lashkar-e-Taiba or Huji-B in the Kashmiri context, and then those inspired either individually in lone wolf context or in small cells via the internet. Let me talk to you a little bit, at least as to how I see the threat evolving and why it's important and why it makes it so complicated, I think, from a counterterrorism perspective. I was at the White House from 05 to 09, and I would say the environment now is much more complicated than what we had to deal with, even at the height of the problems of Iraq, in part because of the diversity of the terrorist problem. You have recruits being drawn to the movement from all over the world in ways that are unconventional. You merely need to look at Abdul Muttalib, the Nigerian student in London, who found his way into the arms of al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula in Yemen, whereas you would have traditionally expected him to reach al-Qaeda core in Pakistan, given the fact that he was studying in London, or found his way into the hands of al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb. But instead, what you have is a global diversity emerging among the groups and a blending of the very groups. And so not only do you have an embedding of the global agenda, but you have a blending of the groups that makes it very hard for U.S. counterterrorism officials to deal with the issues. Plus, you've got the American problem, I think, with greater frequency, and a persistence of the narrative. And the narrative, I completely agree with Peter, and it's one of the things I've argued for a long time, that al-Qaeda is losing the argument. It's losing the ideological debate. The problem is the underlying narrative, the narrative that subscribes that the United States and the West is at war with Islam, and that there's a duty on behalf of all Muslims to actually fight and defend fellow Muslims. That being the core baseline of the extremist narrative, that narrative actually has not diminished. And if you look at some of the interviews that Tony Blair has given on his recent book, Charlie Rose asked him, what are some things that you've found out now that you wish you had known? And one of the things he says is, I wish I had understood how deep that narrative actually is. Not that there are more terrorists out there than we assume, but that there's a more ingrained notion of that narrative upon which terrorist groups rely to recruit, to raise funds, to radicalize. And so I think the persistence of that narrative, the depth of it, even amidst the opposition to al-Qaeda's program and agenda and strategy, is really interesting. And so in some ways, I think we're also in a period of paradoxes, because you've got al-Qaeda core, as described by these fine gentlemen, in decline, in very real decline, morally, theologically, in terms of its core leadership, while the movement feels like it's metastasized and the threat feels like it's growing. You've got smaller attacks in some ways garnering the same types of reactions as the big attacks in the past. As I said, the ideology, the core ideology is maintained even though al-Qaeda and its leadership is opposed, even from within jihadi circles and Muslim communities, and even with American popularity much higher than it has been. And also a sense that we've done relatively well fighting the enemy over there, but there's still now emerging an enemy within, as described by Peter and Mitch. And so it's this odd period where not only is the threat shifting, but our perception of it is stuck in these paradoxes. And I think it creates all sorts of tensions for the counterterrorism community and also politically, as you look at how politicians have to talk about this. Just one point, and I want to test this in part because we've got Peter here, and Peter is one of the foremost authorities on the mind of al-Qaeda. But I do think al-Qaeda in some ways has stumbled into new strategies. I mean, I think we tend to ascribe too much to al-Qaeda's ability to drive things globally. But I do think they're very good at taking advantage of opportunities presented to them. And I think there are three lessons and adaptations that we have to keep in mind strategically that al-Qaeda or Lashkar-e-Taiba or some of the more organized groups that can actually organize globally are taking advantage of. First, the notion that disruption vice destruction can be just as effective against the United States. The reaction to the failed attacks that we've seen over the last couple of years has not gone unnoticed in jihadi circles. They realize that even a failed attack, even a bungled attack, can elicit a huge response from the United States, investment of millions of dollars, and political turmoil in the current environment. That's not lost on them. They're sophisticated enough to understand that. And so that suggests perhaps a sense that disruption in their context is more important. And it's more than just small attacks versus big attacks. I think they could attack us, they would attack us any way they could. But it's more that model. Second, I think you've seen more and more this notion of baiting the United States to overextend itself. You've seen it in the context of Yemen, with al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula speaking in those terms. You've seen it with the al-Shabaab, actually sort of baiting the United States directly, saying, come on, we want to see you bring troops in. Bring them in, we'll fight. And so there was this myth of bin Laden having wanted to bait the United States into a quagmire in Afghanistan, which I think is just hokum. And in fact, the open letter that just came out from the LIFG leader speaks precisely to that, this was unintended, that there are many people within al-Qaeda circles that didn't want to see 9/11 happen. They anticipated a reaction, and it was a reaction that they didn't like. But I think the narrative of baiting the United States into regional conflicts or into quagmires is starting to become part of not only the narrative, but also the strategy. And then finally, the notion of economically bleeding the United States, which I think has been amplified post the financial crisis. You've seen this in how the al-Qaeda leadership talks about these issues. You see it in terms of the Afghan campaign harkening back to the Soviet Mujahideen victory, which the myth of that is that the Mujahideen unto themselves crumbled one of the great superpowers. And the way to do it now, certainly, is to bleed the sole remaining superpower. But I think, again, more than just part of the narrative, it has become and is becoming part of the strategy, and it fits in. And I think we have to keep that in mind. All that said, I think it creates huge complications from a counterterrorism perspective. In three bundles, I would say, and I'll do this very quickly. One, the fact that you have a greater frequency of Americans involved, and also sort of a political consensus growing. I think, Peter, your report will add to this. There's going to be congressional hearings next week that feeds off of this. That raises huge questions. If the enemy is within, and if the enemy is within in a context in which there's a lot of tension, given the mosque debate, the Quran burning, et cetera, what does that mean? What does it mean for domestic intelligence purposes? Do we move to an NYPD model around the country in major metropolitan areas? What does it mean for targeting American citizens abroad? We've seen this debate emerge with respect to Anwar al-Awlaki. Is he an enemy combatant? How can he be targeted? What is the role of at-risk communities? And how do you engage at-risk communities without making them feel targeted and exacerbating the problem? And so the fact that you have Americans featuring more prominently in the movement creates policy questions, legal questions, that we haven't fully grappled with, and I think it will be complicated. Secondly, the regional dimension of this, the fact that we're not just worried about the Afghan-Pakistan border, the fact that attacks on the homeland can come from Yemen, can come from Somalia, could emerge from North Africa, could come from urban areas in Europe. That creates a sense of global assault, if you will, and one that challenges the U.S. government at a time where we don't want to overextend ourselves and of fiscal constraints. And so we can't be everywhere around the world, yet we can't ignore safe havens that are producing jihadis that are willing to attack us here at home. And so what does that mean for our strategies? How can we innovate? Then you have the ideological question. If what is at core here is this narrative and a sense of violent exclusionary identity to the exclusion of all others, and bin Laden, remember, called 9/11 the grand Muslim awakening, how do you attack this ideologically? And how do you do it effectively? Because the U.S. government can't do it effectively. It's not a credible voice in a theological debate. Some would say even in a moral or international political debate. So what does that look like? How do you enlist credible voices? How do you create a grassroots counter-movement of those who are actually opposing the ideology, which exists out there and most folks aren't aware of? And so how do you do that? And then finally, I would say, we're in desperate need of disciplining our response. In the first instance, I think we can't overreact. We have to have a deeper sense, and I think this is sort of now common knowledge and discussion in counterterrorism circles. We have to have a sense of resilience. Every attack or attempted attack can't elicit the same type of maximalist response because it feeds the enemy. It allows them a sense that they can disrupt versus destruct. Two, we have to have a sense of threat taxonomy. You know, what are the real threats to our national security? I have a problem, I'm with the media now, CBS News, but I have a problem when we equate the Jihad Janes of the world with the Najibullah Zazis of the world. You know, those are very different actors, very different plots, and we have to have a sense of threat taxonomy. In that context, I also think we have to be extremely conscious, and this goes into the political dimensions of this, extremely conscious of the unity of the country. Because I think at the heart of the greatest existential threat to our country from Al-Qaeda or this movement or the ideology is that our society become rent between members of our society where those divisions never existed before 9/11. I mean, the grand success for bin Laden, in my mind, would be to see emerging in the United States polity and in our society a division between Muslim American communities and the rest of the United States. And so I applaud President Obama when he says, there is no they, it's us. And I think we need to start perceiving that as part of the strategic approach to defending against the ideology and Al-Qaeda. And then finally, I would just say, all of this affects our lexicon. I was part of an administration where we talked about the war on terror. I understand there are problems with that. I also see utility in calling it what it is in terms of use of military force and other things. That's a different debate. But I think we've got a challenge here because we're talking about a metastasized movement in some ways, or a hydra. Yet the administration necessarily wants to constrain the discussion, wants to talk about a war on Al-Qaeda. Well, in some ways, that doesn't describe the problem that we're facing. And it certainly doesn't describe the problem we're facing in Afghanistan or the potential problems we would see, for example, if Lashkar-e-Taiba were to take on the global mantle of leadership of this global jihad. And so I think lexicon actually is very complicated here because how we talk about the enemy starts to determine how we can respond and how we talk about it in political and public discourse. And so I think we're in a very complicated time, a diversified threat, and one that will present this administration, I think future administrations, with novel challenges.
Okay, so the thing about the lexicon is interesting because we no longer have enemy combatants, but we sort of haven't agreed what they are. We no longer have a war on terror, but we don't have that. We have a lot of words have been taken away from us for understandable reasons and perhaps good reasons, but no words put in their place. So that's good because now we can. But I have another question for you, which is, and maybe this is unfair to ask you, and I don't mean it in a combative way because it
I'm no, used
it may
to it.
Sound
okay.
No, but I'm not feeling combative. I'm feeling thoughtful, and I really mean this in a thoughtful way, which is, how the heck did we get here? We had 9/11. Yeah. We had a strategy, and this is what our strategy brought us. We have a strategy where we're now saying that the threats are different but magnified, that it's the enemy within as well as the enemy without, that we're worried about attacks at home, we're worried out there, we don't know how to distinguish between a Jihad Jane and a Najibullah Zazi. We've rent between Muslims and non-Muslims, between people who identify with civil liberties and people who don't. And I really mean this, and I don't think you're responsible for this at all, but have you given any thought? Have you given any thought? And I invite anybody else to because I think that this, we all need to think about this, is that we are still in a reactive mode. And is anybody, maybe in the Obama administration, maybe outside of it, thinking maybe we're still on the same course we've always been on, and if this is what it brings, is this really what, I hate to put that all on you, but.
No, it's great. And frankly, it's, I think, a symptom of Washington where people are in positions of responsibility and they don't take responsibility for things that happen under their watch. And so I'm happy to take responsibility and answer for certain things that I was responsible for. I think a lot of this we anticipated, and I've talked to Peter a lot about this in the context of his forthcoming book. We saw what Al-Qaeda was trying to do in terms of franchises using regional groups and conflicts as what I called lily pads strategically. We knew there was a problem in terms of homegrown. We never thought we had a London problem, and I don't think we do, and I don't think it's a binary choice here, but I think we do have a problem, and we've traditionally had it. I think there are two problems in my mind. One, not getting Al-Qaeda core leadership early on was a problem. in terms of dealing with the threat, because I think even today, the movement is held together ideologically by that core, and especially in the early days post 9/11. And so I think we all regret, I was not at the White House then, but I think we all regret that we didn't capture bin Laden at Tora Bora. I think it would have been a much different environment. And I think at that moment, leadership mattered even more than it does now. Secondly, I think we didn't fully appreciate collectively, those of us in the business I think did, but the depth of this narrative and the fact that there was a growing sense of grievance globally, upon which Al-Qaeda and other groups were already tapping and were going to tap. And so anything we did, whether it was the invasion of Afghanistan, Iraq, Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo, whatever the image was, the policy, it was going to feed into that. And I think that's part of it. And you know, I don't want to be Pollyannish about it, but we did talk about a generational struggle. We talked about this as not just being a matter of, getting rid of Al-Qaeda and the Taliban, but actually something we saw coming. And in that regard, I do think sort of the long war lexicon made sense. One quick point on lexicon on Al-Qaeda that I think matters, especially now. I think we run the danger of aggrandizing Al-Qaeda at this point. And so anytime we talk about all of these problems purely through the lens of Al-Qaeda, not only are we potentially being short-sighted because there may be other iterations of the problem around the corner that don't involve Al-Qaeda, but it aggrandizes Al-Qaeda in a way that suggests that they're driving all of this, and I don't think they are at this point.
Mm-hmm. Peter, did you want to comment before I open it up for questions? Is there anything?
No, I think that was great.
Okay. So let me open it up for questions. Is there, otherwise I have a million questions. Are there any questions, comments, thoughts? Bob?
I find it difficult to...
Hang on, Bob. Wait for the microphone.
I truly find it difficult to understand how Tony Blair and people in the White House could not understand the depth of the narrative, the depth of the grievances, when there was a war going on, two wars going on, when in fact somebody like Mohammed El-Baradei, a Nobel Prize winner, can sit at the Council on Foreign Relations and say a million Iraqis have died, 3 million Iraqis have been wounded, 4 million Iraqis have been left homeless. I mean, when somebody of that level is using those numbers, which are probably exaggerated, I find it difficult to understand that within the White House, within 10 Downing Street, there wasn't an understanding of the depth of the grievances here. I don't know how that evolves, and that's essentially my question.
I never said we didn't appreciate that in the White House, or at least when I was there at the NSC. I think we clearly did. And if you look at the 2006 national strategy, which came out under my watch and the president put out, that's central to the strategy. And one of the conundrums I think we were facing, and one of the problems I think of the post-invasion in Iraq context. I think absolutely right. I can't speak for Tony Blair, but that's what he said in the Charlie Rose interview. Now, it may be that he wasn't aware how widespread it was in non-Arab countries. I don't know. I can't speak for him. But I was merely suggesting that that narrative is much deeper and ingrained than opposition to Al-Qaeda and Al-Qaeda's ideology and leadership. That baseline narrative is still persistent, even with President Obama, in the leadership position, even with anything and everything we do and say to say we're not at war with Islam, regardless of how much aid and assistance we provided during the tsunami, the Pakistani earthquake relief, the Pakistani floods, you know, that gets lost. But you're absolutely right. I think we were seized with the fact that we were facing a broader ideological challenge that the terrorists were taking full advantage of. And it was just a reality we had to deal with, at least when I was at the White House.
And can I comment on that, which is that, I mean, part of the problem, of course, is the Muslim world's problem. It's not just our problem. I mean, when you've got a recent poll in Egypt, something like 60% of Egyptians said the Jews were behind 9/11. And that's a very routine view. So when you're dealing with that level of conspiracist view, explanations of the world, how do you combat that? I mean, I don't think that's an easy thing to combat.
Gentleman over here.
Thanks very much. thanks for three great talks there. And I just wanted to ask you, Al-Qaeda will come to an end, of course, like all these movements come to an end eventually. And it has certain obvious weaknesses. But what do you think we can do to accelerate its demise?
I would say nothing. I mean, these groups are sort of imploding. I mean, when I say, because the question is who should be doing this? And I think that, as Juan mentioned, I mean, there's the kiss of death problem with the United States government. There's the lack of knowledge that we have. And I mean, at the end of the day, Muslims are making their own decisions about Al-Qaeda. They've already made, most of them have made their own decisions, and it's quite negative. And I think we should be cognizant of that fact, but do nothing about it, because I don't think that we neither have a level of religious knowledge, and we also, we're just not seen as an honest messenger.
Well, so that would be what we shouldn't do anything. But is there something we shouldn't do as opposed to it? You get what I'm saying? So, for example, a lot of the rhetoric that you see now in the press is we shouldn't do this because it'll antagonize the Muslim world, whatever that. We shouldn't. Even the mosque issue has come to that. So are there certain things not to do, or is it really doesn't matter across the board?
Well, I wouldn't be invading any other Muslim countries in the near future. But I mean,
like Yemen or anything like that.
No, just to answer Richard's. I mean, I do think I can totally agree with Juan that, I mean, and finding or capturing or killing Bin Laden would actually have a pretty significant role on Al Qaeda and the larger jihad movement. I think that would be the single most useful thing we could do.
And that's going to happen, right?
No, as we discussed. Not immediately.
Could I just add to that? I completely agree. And I also think, Richard, as you look at the safe havens around the world, coming up with more creative strategies to contain the metastasizing of those problems that present local as well as regional problems and then potentially global. And so I often point to the success that has been had in Southeast Asia, not complete success, but relative success. Recall that right after 2001, most considered Southeast Asia to be the second front. You remember the foreign affairs articles, et cetera. Mm-hmm. What you've had was very good collective action by responsible states enabled by the Australians and the United States, the UN and others, coming together to actually deplete the ability of these networks to be more than locally relevant. And I think constraining the global reach of the local insurgencies or groups that potentially tap into this global ideology becomes very important. But it can't be the United States coming in with troops. I completely agree.
It may be important, but it's also going to be somewhat difficult in the age of the internet. I mean, I don't know how.
I don't think you get rid of the lone wolf. And I think at the end of the day, I agree with Peter that, you know, much of the countering of the ideology, the justification for the use of violence based on the ideology, has to come from within the communities that are most effective and that are most credible in countering it. And so when I was at the White House, one of the things we talked a lot about and tried to do is very difficult from the U.S. government standpoint is how do you help those who are actually trying to do it? How do you foment a grassroots counter movement to this global movement? Because they exist, the ex-jihadis, mm-hmm. the musicians, certain clerics, all sorts of networks, but they're not galvanized. They're not led like Al-Qaeda leads this mm-hmm. global movement. How do you do that? I think that's part of the solution.
If we were to pull out of Afghanistan, what would be the effect on the Muslim world? Would that be a positive effect, or would it exacerbate any of the problems that we have? Assuming that Obama says enough is enough, whether it's this year or next year, but shortly, that we terminate all military operations in Afghanistan.
Yeah, it's very interesting. Something didn't happen after 9/11 that could have happened and might have been predictable, but it didn't happen. No major Muslim cleric said the war in Afghanistan was a classic defensive jihad. I think that's incredibly important because all sorts of major Muslim clerics said that the Iraq war was a classic defensive jihad. Now, this is not an arcane matter of Islamic theology. It's actually why thousands of Americans ended up dead in Iraq. Because a defensive jihad, there are two reasons you can go to war. One is defensive, one is offensive. The offensive verses of the Quran, when the sacred months are passed, you can kill the infidels, essentially. And those are somewhat controversial. I mean, not everybody's, Bin Laden invokes them all the time. But there's no debate about a defensive jihad. That's when non-Muslims invade a Muslim country, as the Soviets did in 1979. And no Muslim cleric said anything along the lines of you should go to war. I think that's incredibly important. And also, all sorts of major Muslim clerics within a week of 9/11 said that this was a crime. The United Nations came out with a very unusually very strong statement on September 12th. NATO invoked Article 5 for the first time in its history. And this war was done, a lot of people around the Muslim world saw that this was legitimate. And one test of that is if you looked at the pro-Bin Laden demonstrations after 9/11 in Karachi and Jakarta, which are two of the world's largest cities, like 10,000, 20,000 people. If you looked at the anti-Iraq war demonstrations in the same city, there were million-man marches in Karachi and Jakarta. So I think that gives you a sense. So I think, I don't think if we pull out of Afghanistan, I mean, apart from all the things that I think is a very bad idea for us to pull out of Afghanistan, Taliban would come back, Al-Qaeda would follow, all that. I mean, I think there is an understanding that this is a legitimate, somewhat legitimate, even in the Muslim world. And one other indicator, by the way, is that there are small numbers, but significant numbers of Muslim soldiers in Afghanistan, certainly weren't in Iraq. Turkey was in charge of ISAF in 2003. The Jordanians have a small contingent. UAE has a small contingent. This is not seen as an illegitimate project in the Muslim world. And by the way, plenty of Muslim countries understand the Taliban returning to power. Even I think in the Pakistanis understand that a Taliban regime in Afghanistan doesn't suit their long-term interests, because no country has been more harmed by the blowback from their very ill-advised support of the Taliban than Pakistan today. They want a pliant, weak Afghan regime. They don't want Mullah Omar back in Kabul.
Francesca.
So I have a similar reaction to this idea of the American or homegrown jihadis that you have to this idea of the threat and having collapsed it. And I'm wondering if we could get something more of a definition of homegrown and what concerns we're actually having in regards to homegrown or American jihadis. If we're talking about galvanizing the community, then I have my doubts about whether this would reach a Colleen LaRose or a Mohammed Alessa. And if we're just talking about whether or not these guys have rights, then let's be upfront about that.
So just to clarify, the question is, how do you define the homegrown? Well, you know, I think that what concerns us the most about homegrown, and by homegrown we mean the radicalization process of that individual happened for our purposes in the United States. But that is not necessarily the end of the story, because, you know, up until Zazi traveled to Pakistan, up until Faisal Shahzad traveled to Pakistan, in a sense you could say those guys are just homegrown. The problem is that when these individuals seek to go overseas and they make that fortuitous, serendipitous connection and have increased capability and then return. So, you know, one of the examples I talked about was these two individuals in New Jersey who were homegrown, except for the fact that they were looking to fly via Egypt and get the Somalian fight. And if land of the jihad, they were sent to come back, they'd come back. So the homegrown has the potential for a great deal, to cause a great deal more of havoc than just, you know, leaving them to sort of sit, you know, in Flushing or in Bridgeport, Connecticut. They can magnify the threat that they provide based on connections they make.
Let me just, what if somebody lived in this country their entire life and took a trip to the Middle East and was radicalized over there? Would you call that not a homegrown terrorist?
Right. So Carlos Bledsoe is an individual who shoots at an Arkansas recruiting station and kills the recruiter and injures another person.
Right.
He traveled to Yemen in that travel, and he spent some time there, and that preceded the attack.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in our book, he's not homegrown. He's actually, you know, quote unquote, Yemen grown. He's an American, but that's where he radicalized. So I think where the person radicalized is the key thing.
I mean, I think that's interesting, and I'd kind of like to open that up for another day, perhaps, because it's how the British define it. I know that, and I understand that in their context. But from the point of view of keeping us safe and understanding what homegrown is, I mean, would you agree with me to say, or would any of you agree with me, that we don't really have a definition of homegrown yet? We don't have a sense of time. We don't have a sense of any of these issues, or would you say that just radicalization is it and we don't really need to go much further to think about what the different possible definitions of it could be? What do you think?
You know, one of the interesting things that we looked at a number of years ago was the 9/11 plot. And in the 9/11 plot, three of the pilots, so three of the 19, we would say radicalized in Hamburg, Germany. And we've met with the Hamburg police and German counterterrorism officials in a sense, so who owns the problem? That's one way of looking at it. So multiple people could own it. And you could argue that the Hamburg police and the German intelligence and security, they owned Mohammed Atta, they owned Marwan al-Shahi, Ramzi bin al-Shib. They owned these guys as the problem because they didn't detect them, stop them. They then subsequently went to Afghanistan, but even that was serendipity because they were originally going to go to Chechnya until they didn't. So, you know, you could say who owns the problem, and that may be one way you could look at defining the issue.
Just real quickly, I think the definition can be fluid, but I think largely it's individuals who've been radicalized, who subscribe to the ideology of using violence based on all the ideological tenets that we know. And I think the most dangerous dimensions of that are those that are willing to connect with the global jihadist elements of it. That is to say, those who are willing to independently travel abroad to connect with organized elements of the movement. The reason that's important and that distinction's important is because the lone wolf may be dangerous, but what is more dangerous are the groups of actors who are trained well, assuming they're trained well, and then deployed. Recall the August 06 transatlantic plane plot. You know, that was targeting 10 flights headed from London to North America. That was a real plot. That they were trained by Al-Qaeda. They were collective together. These weren't Americans, but they were British nationals. Those, you know, that's a more serious national security threat than, God forbid, a singular attack or a lone wolf attack, which you want to prevent, but that's very different. And that goes to the threat taxonomy. But I think the definition is fluid. It depends in part on what you're most worried about.
You know, actually, this is kind of interesting, and we're not going to resolve this here, and I want to hear what Joshua has to say about it. But, you know, training has consistently been one of the flags. You know, if you go abroad to train, that's it. Done deal. You know, forget even placing the explosives. It's the training. But if you take the internet seriously, and if you take radicalization over the internet seriously, and if you take training over the internet seriously, which has nothing to do with going to Pakistan or being, you know, then you say it's a lone wolf. Really, is it a lone wolf who goes into a mall and takes a gun because Awaki over the internet, who is American, says, you know, you should do this? Is that really less of a threat than the kinds of things that you're talking about Abu Mutalib coming over on a plane? So I'm just suggesting that the homegrown terrorism thing is actually very much about how we define our security. And it's not that, look, we haven't used the lone wolf provision of the Patriot Act, right? We haven't yet used it. And so it's not that, you know, I'm just saying that I'm suggesting that maybe we don't really have a handle on what homegrown terrorism is. And that maybe we should think about it because maybe, and one of the reasons I think we don't think about it, let me just suggest, is that we are very rooted into the idea that this is somehow tied to the Muslim religion. And while it may be in the last stages tied to the Muslim religion of people who are converting and we're seeing all these conversions, that maybe there's something else that we're not looking at and considering. And I'm just suggesting.
That's absolutely fair.
And I think that's what Francesco was meaning to suggest.
I think that's right. And I think one of the challenges, and we've talked about this, and Mitch has written on this, you know, there isn't a homogenous radicalization process. I mean, it's very different, and it's very different depending on what layers of the terrorist threat you're talking about. You know, the radicalization and the ideology mentality of Ayman al-Zawahiri is very different from a jihad Jain, and there's every gradation in between, and the lack of nuance of that actually is important, because I don't think we're very good at drawing those distinctions, and that matters.
And we don't have a taxonomy.
But I would say one thing. I think we shouldn't discount the importance of the physical contact, even in the radicalization context, to the radicalization of the individual and the quality of the quality in quotes of the threat posed by individuals. I think in-person training still matters qualitatively.
Yes, and if you find out that it's in the family, you know, and intergenerational in that way, then it's a whole other can of worms, and that's all from Jesse. Mr. Dreitel.
I appreciate Mitchell's attempt at precision for the homegrown definition, but I think it's too one-dimensional in this sense. If someone like Hassan, Major Hassan, is sitting at a computer corresponding with someone from Yemen, is he really radicalized here? You know, and if someone's listening to tapes from Al-Alawi, who's in Yemen is really being radicalized. Just, I think it defies precision, which is the problem with it. I think it's really a buzzword that the media has seized on, and I think that there are, and I don't begrudge this at all because I understand the nature of the way the system operates, but I think it's because of the obsessive interest in the media in the term, I think that both politicians and law enforcement have used it as a focus, because I think there are public relations and political advantages to it. And I'm not saying, I don't really begrudge it, because if it's a way to focus on a particular problem, I don't have a problem, but I do see it as a common thread for 20 years, going back to the first World Trade Center plot, where there were Americans, converts, all of that, through, and every example that you can give, I can give you a parallel example of pre-9/11, whether it's John Walker Lind, or the Lackawanna 6, or the Paintball, Virginia Paintball crew, you know, most of whom converted during Desert Storm. That's their origin, with Islam at all. Padilla, all these are, you know, really pre-9/11. So I think there are other factors involved. You know, Columbus discovered America, the Native Americans said, hey, maybe you discovered it, but maybe for your purposes now, but it's been here before. And, you know, if you go back to I don't know the comparison of numbers, but I would venture a guess, that the number of Americans, and when I say Americans, people living in the United States, many of whom were of Arab origin, but the number of Americans recruited by Abdullah Azzam at the behest of the United States through his tour through the United States in the early 80s, the poster, the architect of essentially the global jihadist response to Afghanistan in many ways, Abdullah Azzam, the spiritual underpinning of that, was brought to the United States to recruit at colleges. And how many Americans, like I said, many of Arab origin, went to Afghanistan through, there was an entire mosque in Brooklyn, Al-Farouk, and I know Mitchell must be very familiar with it, that was dedicated to transiting people from the United States to Afghanistan to participate in jihad, or to Pakistan to participate in jihad, all that well before 9/11. The other is, I think that it's also a demographic problem to the extent that it has any substance. And I think the numbers that Karen talked about show that it doesn't really have substance as a new phenomenon or a phenomenon. But to the extent that it has any substance at all, it is a demographic issue rather than a gross numbers issue. And this is what I mean. The United States has done a far better job since 9/11 of closing the borders to external threats entering the country. So what you have then is, for every law enforcement dollar, is going to focus on people in the United States who have been in the United States for a long time. It's just a matter of resource allocation. It's inevitable. And I'll give you an example. As a criminal defense attorney since 1980, basically, I can tell you that this parallels in the early part of the 1980s, in the 70s through the early part of the 1980s, most marijuana came from Colombia. It came in large shipments by sea. And then the United States effectively, as the Reagan administration, blockaded the United States' eastern and western seaboard from Colombian ships bringing in marijuana. What happened next is, of course, hydroponic and other marijuana cultivation in the United States. So what you have now, years later, is, of course, all the major marijuana cases are all domestic. That's a pure demographic nature of how the issue will be evolved. Yeah. The other reason I think that homegrown, if it has any substance at all, is, again, not a gross numbers, but is that informants and undercover agents have a far easier time infiltrating and cultivating people in the United States who have been here, who are westernized, who are part of the community, rather than people who come here intent on a jihadist plot. Mm-hmm. They're going to be more secretive, they're going to be more exclusive, they're going to be more in contact with people outside the United States, and frankly, all the Americans, you know, will be westernized people who talk trash at a level that's, you know, totally incriminating, as we found out in this case. So I think that's, you know, and I'm not trying to be value-laden about it at all, I'm just trying to keep it to the point where it reflects a perspective broader than a journalist's intent on getting a story and keeping a story alive.
Of course. I think that would
be good. Karen, I want to touch on Karen. You said strategy. I want to know what that strategy was.
For what?
Me, looking at the post 9/11 U.S. response, is all tactical and not strategic, in the sense that it's a guy who has mosquitoes and he's just slapping and scratching bites instead of thinking about, should I close the window? Should I get a screen? Should I buy some rain?
That was my worry.
I would disagree, but that's okay.
Do you want to respond?
Yeah, I would just add one issue on the homegrown definition. You know, I think no one has defined it in an official sort of way, but I think one has to ask themselves the question, if not homegrown, then what? Unhomegrown? No, overseas, right? So that's sort of the way this is framed. If they're not homegrown, wherever your home may be, you know, country-wise, then overseas. So I think that's really, when people are attempting to describe it, the issue we're talking about. So 9/11, you know, none of those people were radicalized in the United States. That's not a homegrown plot for the U.S. You know, so it's that issue of overseas versus home. I think, you know, sort of simplicity on this one may be best. And just on the Abdullah Azzam and the numbers, you know, that was for individuals going to fight, as you say, overseas against the Russians. So that was the good fight. That was a fight that America was on board with. So those people weren't joining terrorist groups. They were joining our allies and executing U.S. foreign policy. So that, you know, I would say that you don't probably count those guys, you know, in any calculation.
I would say that's a semantic difference of the type of offensive versus in this sense, if you look at the, just to give you an example, if you talk about the computer, talking, I guess, about offensive versus defensive in that, and I'm not trying to promote one idea over another, but it's difficult to distinguish between offensive and defensive jihad when the concept of preemptive war is adopted by us.
Peter, did you have something you wanted to say before we close?
I mean, you know, Josh is completely right. There were, you know, Ayman al-Zawahiri came to the United States to recruit people, and al-Qaeda essentially had a branch office in Brooklyn just next door to the Farouk Mosque.
Sure.
It was called the Services Office. I interviewed people there from 1993, and I looked back at the interviews after 9/11, and they were talking about the Services Office. At the time, I had no idea what they were talking about. Of course, that was the name that bin Laden gave his group at the time in the mid-80s. But obviously, in the post-9/11 environment, traveling to join al-Qaeda is different than joining Abdullah Azzam's jihad against the Soviets. If you're an American, you kind of know that there was a difference, I think.
You know, I'm struck by kind of an interesting thought, which I always try to have so that we're not scared. You know, we have to end not being scared, not being upset, all being at peace. Okay, so it gets more and more challenging as the years go by. But I am struck by something very odd about tonight's conversation, which is how much that we are completely and utterly in a globalized world. And that might sound really, you know, obvious, but it's not an obvious thing. And sort of sit here and we toss around, you know, a variety of places and terms, but the problem is it's not like when you went to graduate school 20, 30, 40 years ago, depending on what decade you are, 10. And you learned about something that was over there, and isn't it nice to have done that? It's here. And somehow this globalized term, which we also throw around like other terms, means something in the context of terrorism and counterterrorism. And so homegrown terrorism actually may be a obsolete term by the time we define it. And that one of the reasons we're having defining these terms, because I like Juan's idea of needing a lexicon, is that as long as we continue to make these distinctions, they belong to the 20th century. And, you know, if nothing else, this oil disaster in the Gulf has shown us is that it's not so easy to contain things in a fluid, open environment. And perhaps, you know, that's the metaphor for what we have with terrorism. You know, I always tell our guests when they come to the center, like, watch out for this audience. They've been coming for 8 years. They know what they're talking about. Don't talk down to them. Mm-hmm. And tonight, you have really made me honest in that statement. Please join me in thanking our guests, and thank you.